Session for the North City Council will commence. Dr. Filer, the floor is yours.
Thank you, sir. Good evening, Mayor, Vice Mayor, members of council. Good to see everybody. This evening, we've got a pretty busy agenda. We've got several representatives from Dominion Energy here. Several meetings ago, we had a conversation about streetlights and the process and the differences in the process between situations where, say, bulbs are out and how that gets reported versus situations where we believe we might need some new lights or lights have been, poles have been damaged and things like that. So Paula Miller is here. She's the Legislative Affairs and Senior Communications Specialist with Dominion, and she's graciously brought some of her team as well to talk through this process, and then, you know, we'll have a conversation then with council individually. I think Mr. Burek has reached out to each of you about particular spots in your wards where you may have some concerns, and then we'll hopefully have a good path forward to talk not only about addressing the current bulb situation, but transitioning from the bulbs we currently have over to LED bulbs, and then also some repair work. And then after that, sir, we have several items for closed session this evening.
All right, thank you, Benita, Paula, welcome, and your team.
Thank you.
See you.
Good afternoon, council and mayor and city manager Filer. Thank you. Appreciate you having us and your staff for helping getting us here today. Been most appreciative. We've had several great conversations, and hopefully by the end of our presentation today, we'll have answered most of your questions, or at least can get you answers to any remaining questions that you do have. Before we get started, I wanted to introduce you to a couple of my colleagues. Most of you probably know Benita Harris, who is our Eastern Region Policy Director. In front of Benita is Jerry Northedge. She gets the prize for driving the furthest today from Loudoun County to be here with you. So she is head of our outdoor lighting program for Dominion across the Commonwealth. So she's very knowledgeable about everything street lighting, outdoor lighting. And to her left is Morgan Murph. Morgan is our Norfolk account manager. So when you have concerns, Morgan or myself or two of the folks that you can address those to. And then to Morgan's left is Rick Bunting. And Rick is the head of construction and operations for the Norfolk office, Dominion Energy's Norfolk office. So hopefully everybody here can answer most of your questions. Little fact, there are 34,286 streetlights in the city of Norfolk, Dominion Energy streetlights, and those don't count the ones that are on private property. So hopefully we can provide a little bit more insight in terms of how we're managing and maintaining them. And then also, I know you had some questions about turnaround time for outages and all. We'll address that. And I had some questions, thank you, about LED lights. So I'm going to ask Morgan Murph to come up and offer some comments about those 34,000 lights. Thanks, Morgan.
Well, thank you very much, Paula. Thank you, Norfolk City Council, for having us today, this afternoon. Again, my name is Morgan Murph, key account manager for Dominion Energy, and City of Norfolk is one of my customers. So I want to make sure you all are happy, and that's one of my job responsibilities, and it's good to meet you. A few things I'm going to talk about today are outage reporting process for the citizens of Norfolk, how we maintenance process for maintaining streetlights for Dominion Energy, and then our current state of streetlights in the city of Norfolk. So starting off here, let's see what we have up here. Currently, we ask the City of Norfolk citizens report streetlight outages by utilizing one of these two options. Our preferred option being the online, going to www.dominionenergy.com and reporting the streetlight that is out. Second option is our customer service center at 1-866-366-4357. Both options that citizens can use to report the streetlights that are out. Our customer service center does have an identified team who takes this information, whether it's submitted online or by phone and puts it into our streetlight outage reporting system. And from there, it goes into our trouble reporting system to be troubleshot or maintained. With daylight savings time just occurring, we do expect, which occurs every year, an uptick in calls or project centered. So, like I said, we usually see that this time of year with daylight savings time ending. Our maintenance for streetlights, we have a dedicated contingent of resources for streetlight maintenance. That is split between Dominion Energy's resources and our contractors. We currently have contracts with MasTec and River City, who helps us with our work to maintain streetlights throughout the city. So there's almost like two categories for maintaining streetlights. There's the first response. This is where a streetlight is submitted that's out. It will go into our trouble reporting system. We'll go out and troubleshoot the light and see exactly what the issue is. Typically, this is replacing a bulb and an eye. An eye is where it tells the streetlight assembly if it's daytime or nighttime, or dawn or dusk. But typically, this is where most of our work takes place. But in some occasions, follow-up work is necessary, and that work is prioritized primarily from oldest prioritized by oldest being addressed first. Now, in some cases, safety and complexity of the work can change the priority. So if this work looks to take, it's a little bit harder to get done in a timely manner, we may continue to work on the inventory that's coming in and keep these follow-up jobs, and we'll keep those in the backlog to be worked. So when we say safety and complexity of the work priority can change, that's what we mean. Some of this type of work, replace streetlight heads, would be a follow-up example. Repair underground cable, replace underground cable, or any kind of pole damage or pole replacement. These types of projects take a little bit longer than just an immediate response. Some examples of safety would be maybe needing a crash truck to go out and on a primary road to maintenance light. So that work would, we want to make sure our crews are safe, and we need a crash truck for those situations. And then for complexity, it all depends on the type of repair, which changes the duration of how long it would take for us to get a light repaired. So our current state of streetlights in the city, as Paula said, we have 34,286 streetlights. As of yesterday, according to our outage reporting system, we have approximately 300 out in the city. That is first response and follow-up work. So that's where we stand now. With LED lighting with the city of Norfolk, current projects that have been requested from the city add up to about 1,759 lights that the city of Norfolk has requested Dominion to convert to LED. Of those requests, we've completed 1,320 of those lights. That leaves us with about 15 LED projects, or approximately 400 lights that are currently in design or in construction. So that's one way the city has requested lights to be converted to LED, and then there's another way through attrition, where if Dominion goes out and troubleshoots a street light and finds that the head has failed, we'll replace that head with an LED head. So that's another, in a approximate three-year span, 1,500 lights that have been replaced. So where that gets us to today, the city has about 10% of their lights converted to LED. So that's where we stand now. And Ms. Jerry Northedge, she has a good amount of information on LED outdoor lighting that she can help us out with and can share with you all.
All right. Thank you, Morgan. And thank you, Mayor, Council, and other distinguished guests here today for having us to talk about lighting. I've been the outdoor lighting manager for Dominion for a number of years now, And we've gone through about a 100-year change, if you can imagine. Think about the bulbs in your house and changing to LED. For outdoor lighting, this is the biggest change in 100 years. So, and as anything with new technology, when it starts, it goes fast. So excited to be here. Not a stranger to Norfolk. I spent 4 years here, graduated from Old Dominion in 1996. So we have an LED program. Can't see that screen, so I'm just going to look at the page here. Here we go. It's on the screen here. We executed an agreement with the Virginia Energy Purchasing Governmental Association, which is our agreement essentially with the city of Norfolk as well, as you remember, in about August of 2018 timeframe. And when we executed that agreement, we offered a new portfolio of LED lights, a flat rate conversion fee to convert to LEDs, and lower monthly rates. So as you convert to LED, you pay less per month for that light. It's an affordable way for any locality to convert to LED lights. We've made it very attractive. We subsidize the entire process. We pay for the lights. We pay for the labor. The only contribution that the locality makes is really the remaining asset value of that existing light that we're removing. So we've streamlined that process by creating dedicated resources internally. That's design resources, construction resources. So when you initiate these jobs to convert proactively, we have dedicated folks that take that from beginning to end. It's a pretty quick process. Some of the benefits, and you guys probably, again, LED is not new now to most of you because it's not just outdoor lighting at Dominion that has seen this advancement in technology, but there are benefits associated with LED that for both the city, for Dominion, for your citizens here, in that there's improved reliability. I'd say maybe about an LED streetlight is going to last about 4 to 5 times longer than its high-intensity discharge counterpart, all the existing lights we've been putting out there for decades. It's better lighting. You get more clarity with the LED output. It's targeted lumens to the source, so you get light where you want it. Bulb-style lighting, you lose a lot of that light before it gets to the target, so you get better lighting, and that does impact safety, which I know is number one to the city as it is to Dominion. And then I mentioned already lower monthly rates for that lighting, so a discount on top of that. So I mentioned the flat rate conversion fee. So when the city initiates these projects, it's somewhere around $150 per light. For most of the localities we've been working with, and we do have some larger localities that may be at 50, 75% converted, some smaller localities that are 100% converted. Not hard to get 100% if you only have 100 or so lights in a small town, but still, it's a big accomplishment. Those localities are seeing a return on investment very quickly. The payback period is as little as 2 to 3 years with the investment. So just something to consider. We do have dedicated resources here at Dominion that we have in touch with some of your city staff that can help with financial analysis and really handhold throughout the whole process to make sure that we work closely with the city and achieve your conversion strategy very quickly. And I think we had turn it back over to Paula and see if we have any questions today on the material we've looking at.
I remember something that was going to pass along, or made me think when I heard the presentation. Rick had told me when you see a light on during the day, that's a sign that light has failed. So that's one that should be reported as well. The light is on during the day, the street light, that means it's failed. Report that one. So any specific questions, and we can bring the subject matter.
Mr. Riddick, then Ms. Royster, and Mrs. Spiegel had some questions earlier, so I guess he
will. There are a couple of locations on Tidewater Drive. One of them, there is a business complex in the 1400 block, and they've been without lights for 6 months. No lights.
Tidewater Drive. Yeah. Now, And Rick, there is a process. I know it's in terms of he is in regular contact with Frieda. We have a great working relationship with Frieda and keeping the line of communication open on that. And some of these are much more, as you've probably heard in Morgan's presentation, are much more involved than other projects. It's not just a simple turning or replacing the bulb. It's tearing up underground. Some of them are enclosed and the street has to be torn up. Rick, do you want to make any mention of Tidewater?
That location that you're speaking of, Frieda did call me
So I am aware of it. We're going to patrol in this week. I believe there's like 8 lights out from 1400 block to the 2300 block.
2400 block.
Okay, 2400 block.
Now, this is the inner court. We've been dealing with gun violence in Norfolk. And the more lights that we can keep up and on, it might be something that's preventive as far as, you know, somebody trying to commit a crime. Well, it's more difficult now dealing with Dominion than it was when it was BEPCO, you know.
More difficult?
Yeah. Your responses are not as quick.
We really encourage, and we should do that number 300. Mm-hmm. That's the number that we know that are out. If they're not reported, we don't know about them. So we strongly encourage citizens to report either online or at our number, because if they're not reported, we don't know about them.
Do they have trucks that go out, or how is it done now? How are you replacing your lights now?
Well, locally at the local office on Bravo, I've got servicemen. I've got servicemen locally at the office. Now, they are the ones in charge of keeping the power on. Not streetlights, but the power on. And they'll work streetlights, obviously, when they don't have other trouble going on. With the way we operate now, and one of the things I wanted to mention when they were going through the slides is, so I've been in Norfolk a couple years now, and outdoor lighting had just been formed not long after that. And I would say probably a year ago this time, we were 800-900 lights out. Not something we're proud of, but I mean, we've made a lot of headway just in this past year. A big part of it is the outdoor lighting group. So I do a lot of them that Frieda calls me on, and ones that are getting some attention, I try to get to sooner than later. Majority of them for Norfolk go to the outdoor lighting, as do other municipalities, because, I mean, we've taken a huge step in letting outdoor lighting focus nothing on nothing but streetlights. And we've never done that before. But it's working. I guess my point is we're 300. We're much better. We know we still got to get better than that. But just in a year's time, there's been a big difference. So daily, yeah, I'm going to have guys tonight patrolling Tidewater Drive. And we'll get a number. We'll get, if they can set up on them and work them. Tidewater Drive is not a friendly road. We all know that. A lot of times we can get off them and work them. It might be as simple as changing a bulb in an eye and getting that fixture back working. Could be a bad head, and we talked about that earlier. Could be a bad head. They don't carry material like that with them. Now it's a follow-up. Now it's a follow-up position. If it's overhead, we don't have too much problems with the source, the feed overhead, because obviously you can see it, you can look at it, and you can normally track it down and repair it. Underground, entirely different. Obviously we can't see it, so it's a follow-up for that to come back at another time. It's another trip and try to locate the fault for the underground service. And it can get to a point where it could be as simple as we locate it, we dig it up, we fix it, we're good. And a lot of times you can't get to it to fix it, and it will have to be replaced. Well, that's when, you know, it'd be another month or so before we can actually get people out there to drill in cable. So there's a lot of variables that go with it. It could be a very simple fix, but
But it could take some time.
Another question, and it might not be directly related to street lighting, but at the base of Valentine Boulevard and Lafayette Boulevard, that substation there, what does that power?
Is that the small one by the concrete plant?
No, it's right there by Polly's Chicken and People's Cleaners.
Oh, I'm sorry. Fairmont Park.
Yeah.
Fairmont Park, right there in the circle. It's our substation group. It's a building. It's just a building where our substation group, that's where they meet. Years ago, it used to be a power station. Now it's just a building that that group meets at.
And they do what?
They just meet there. That's where it's just an office for them.
So if the city wanted to move that to make the traffic flow, would that be a cost of the city, a cost of Virginia Power?
The answer, Mr. Riddick, would depend upon whether it's there pursuant to the franchise or a separate granted easement that addressed relocation within it. In the franchise, the law in Virginia is that the utility has the obligation to relocate in the event that it's needed for transportation.
Thank you. Thanks so much.
Andrew, do you have a question on that point before I go to Danica?
When you're talking about those lights, Mr. Riddick, in that instance, would you actually replace with LED if you have to go out there, the ones that have been out for 6 months?
If we found that the fixtures themselves were bad, we would replace them with LEDs.
But only if the fixtures are bad, not if it's underground or anything else.
Right. If it's the difference of I can get this on now, like right now. Or it's a follow-up to go back in another trip for someone else to come back.
I mean, it seems like if it's been 6 months, it's probably a follow-up trip. So I just wonder.
But they may be able to get it working. If it's just a bulb, they've got bulbs and eyes with them. That's nothing more than what you do in your house when you change a bulb.
But it wouldn't be 6 months. That would just be a bulb and an eye issue.
As far as till we get there? Is that what you're saying?
Yes. These you said, have been out for 6 months. So presumably, it is a more complicated issue. And my question is, when you have issues that are more than a bulb and an eye, why aren't we just going ahead and replacing immediately?
And we are when it's a bad fixture. That's what they were talking about earlier. So there's been 1,700, I think he mentioned, that have been proactively or when we went to do the maintenance, we've replaced them with LED.
Ms. Royster, then Mr. Spiegel, then Ms. Johnson, Ms. Doyle. Okay, we'll come back to you.
Thank you. One of the things I wanted to inquire about was, I know when we first announced the program for reporting, one of the language that was used on the website was, depending on the repair needed, Dominion will post a color-coded wrap indicating the status of the repair and how long it may take to fix. One of my questions would be, is there any idea or do you all plan on addressing that, communicating that with residents versus just a tag on a pole? Because I think, as it's been indicated, there's several locations. I won't name mine because I gave my list already, but they include some locations Mr. Riddick has mentioned, as well as I'm sure Councilwoman Johnson, where there can be a better sense of communication and a timeline. Because if it's just a light fixture and it's just a fixture thing, I think that should be indicated in a better way. But if it's more underground work, how is that being communicated to residents when it's, you know, impacting an entire neighborhood block or several areas? Because we have trouble areas within, you know, I know Civil War 7, but also throughout the city, where there has been increase in violent crimes, hazards, vehicle things. And I think it's important that there's some type of streamline of communication regarding this is where we are in the process versus a tag that someone would have had to magically know the color code, what that means.
Well, and you're right. The pole tags that they put on the pole, that's the more immediate communication. And there is one states it's an overhead problem. And I can see where some people may not get the full understanding of it. But then there's other pole tags. They're different colors, but the wording's on it that there's an overhead problem here or there's an underground problem. Now, and obviously they could call the call center and get some information from them as well. But I mean, just to walk up to a pole and that was kind of the idea with the poll tags, just to give them a immediate answer.
So do those tags currently say how long something will take?
No, but I mean, overhead streetlights, the overhead fixture itself, I mean, it should be a couple of weeks before we get back to it. If it gets to be undergrounds, it could be a month or so with the drilling process. It's a big difference when we start talking about underground issues. And even when, I mean, we've gotten to the point now that if it's possible, we put a lot of them in temporary. When it's an underground feed and we know it's going to be a month or so before we can get it repaired, we can do some overhead temporary work just to get them burning in the meantime. So I try to do that as much as possible. But I don't know if that answers your question or not.
It kind of does. I just was looking for, is there any other is there another form of communication being considered so that residents are aware of where you are? Because as you just indicated, you know, sometimes that's not so clear.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, with you all being on the inside and knowing what red, green, yellow, purple may mean to a community, that means nothing. They just know that I haven't had lights for 6 months. Or we've been calling in and we haven't been getting a response.
Well, and if it's 6 months, that's a problem in itself, because it shouldn't take that long. No question. And I know those things happen. Mr. Reddick, he just mentioned that on Tidewater Drive. A manageable outage street or streetlight outage should, you know, we should be talking maybe months at the best, not 6 months, 2 to 3 months. I guess specifically, no, there's nothing else to let a customer know other than they would have to call and follow up on that location.
Another question I had is, how do you all manage when a customer, someone calls in about something and an order is canceled and it's still something that's active and it's,
A street light is a street light is out,
mm-hmm.
But the order was canceled.
But they reported the number and they got some type of reference number called back and they called back and it was canceled out and the problem wasn't solved.
The work request was completed, but we might not have completed repair. That's possible. There's a scenario that it would occur. Yeah, we would probably need a specific work request number to research, because if obviously we close a work request associated with an outage, then that means the light should be restored. If we created another work request, because it's a different type of work, and then canceled the original, there should be good notes on that work request to pass along to anyone calling about to share with them.
And if I may add to it, when the word counsel is given to the customer, it means that it has been received and it may have been turned over to the department to take care of the situation. It doesn't often mean that the situation has been handled. Because that's the discussion that I had with Norfolk Cares as well. When it comes back to the citizen, it may say counseled, meaning that we've received it, we've passed it on to the department, but we may not have completed the work, but it's in the process. But when the customer sees counseled, to them it means that you've taken care of it. And it does not necessarily mean that.
I'm thinking of an example that, and it happens, a bad underground may feed a dozen lights. And we find that bad underground and we repair that bad underground. And so we're saying these lights are on. And now they are on. And one of those dozen may have a bad head, and that job was closed out, but the light that's in front of that customer's house, my light's still out. And then we follow up on that. I'm thinking that's a scenario that does happen. I don't know if that would account for all of them, but I just know that happens.
Okay,
Johnson, then Mr. Smigel, and then we're going to go to Ms. Doyle and Ms. McClellan.
I will let ladies go first.
All of them?
No. Just on this side.
All right, Ms. Johnson.
Thank you, sir. So in listening to the report, I look at city responsibility and our citizens' responsibility. And it was stated that the city requested LED lights. My question would be, where was the location? When we're saying that the city requested LED lighting, I want to know where and the location. Does that just involve, thank you, ma'am, does that just include citywide items as far as lighting is concerned, or that does that include neighborhoods? From what I got to from it, it means that the citizens are reporting, are responsible for reporting in their neighborhoods. So I think maybe there needs to be some clarity with that. Here's what I've identified as the city as identifying as far as lighting. Identify all recreation centers because they've had lighting out for quite some time. Identify all libraries. Connect with local businesses. This is huge. Who is holding the local businesses responsible for the lighting of their business so that people can come and shop there? And also all major primary roads. Those would be the things that the city is responsible for. Am I correct?
So
yeah, actually, I would say it's more, even more than that. So our officers patrolling in the evenings are patrolling the whole entire city and taking notes and making notes about bulbs and lights that are out.
Including neighborhoods?
Everything.
Okay.
Everything. So we are not just focused on the city buildings. We're patrolling the whole city.
Okay. That's
and passing that information then along directly. That's the conversation that typically happen between Frieda and Dominion.
Right. And I'm glad that we're doing this. I just think that we need to let our citizens know that we're doing such a great job at identifying the lighting because they're not aware of
right.
it.
Oh,
and
but we still need their help.
Right.
I mean, we do as great of a job as we can do patrolling and you know through our normal course, but we really do need their help on identifying locations that are out.
Exactly, and I'm glad that we gave the presentation that clearly stated what the responsibilities. And I think that that's the part of the communication that the citizens needed to know. What are my responsibilities? What does the city need me to do to help them in identifying the lights that is needed? And the other one I had was public housing. To have the LED lighting in public housing. And lastly, the part about, I think we've already discussed this, dashboards and updates after the reporting, because Councilwoman, you just mentioned how do the citizens know. What I think what is happening is word choice. The words that we use to respond to the citizens. The word council means something to Dominion and the city, but it also is perceived differently to the consumer. To council means that you did just that. And within their minds, they're thinking that, okay, you've already taken care of the problem. And it doesn't mean that. I know it doesn't mean that. I know that. But I think that if we looked at our word choices as far as addressing our citizens, that would be great. And what is the expected wait time and expectation of completion time? How is that communicated to the citizens? So when they call in or send you an email on lighting being out, do they get a response as far as what is the expected completion? completion time. Is there any type of communication between Dominion Power and the person who is sending the email or making the call?
I'm saying yes. I mean, can you be more specific on that?
Question. So when they call us, or if they use the web form, and because then a lot of people don't like to call anymore, so we do have a web form, they have to fill out information. The web form, I'll start with that, they should get a response within about 48 hours. It goes to like our customer service center, folks that aren't on the phones but are taking those emails. So depending on volume, it'd be about 48 hours before they get a response. They will get an email response. They'll get the work request number, and typically at that point, we don't know information yet because we haven't first responded, so we don't know what the problem is yet. Once we know the problem, we already talked about the poll wraps, which if they go to that web page, it gives them, right when they're reporting, it gives them an idea as they're reporting, hey, if you see these poll wraps, this is what it means. Typically, overhead, if it's an overhead issue, it could be up to 2 weeks. If it's underground, it could be 2 to 3 weeks to repair it, or even more if it needs to be replaced. All that information is right there where they're reporting it online at the beginning, before we even know the problem. It's like, whatever it may be, these are the time frames. If they call us, it's the same thing. Our customer service center agents, they have scripts available to them for those types of calls so that they can give those anticipated restoration timelines right while they're on the phone with the citizen that's calling us. Does that help answer?
Yes, ma'am. Okay. I just want to. And Mr. Mayor, lastly, I know you, sir, mentioned, and I think Councilwoman McCullen also made a statement, that when you go out to a call, what is determined whether or not you just put in the same old bulb or the LED and the determining factor? Is there a goal for the city to go completely LED?
Yes, ma'am, there is. So it will require some funds, and I think we'll have to have a conversation with council. It also requires resources on Dominion's end. So we have to have some conversations with Dominion to try and get a sense of how much they could do if we had the funds and we really wanted to get to, you know, say, 100% in a certain number of years. But yes, we then we would also still be dealing with, over those years, we'd be dealing with just the attrition that will take place in some of the heads, which will automatically get converted to LED. But, part of why we wanted Dominion to come is to say to this body, as they have said to us, they have additional resources for LED conversion, and if that is something... This council already allocates every year annually about $200,000 in CIP funds to do conversion, or $200,000 in CIP for conversion. And that gives us a certain amount. So we can absolutely increase that amount, and I think they can produce a conversion, a greater speed of conversion as well.
And Mr. Mayor?
Ms. Johnson?
I want to say
stealing all my ideas.
I'm sorry. That means we're educators, see? I would like to say to the city manager, the mayor, and to my colleagues, it's really nice that we have Dominion Energy here with us this evening, because it has been something we've waited long enough. And I think that the citizens can appreciate us having this discussing this evening as far as how they can better help their city. So thank you so very much. Thank you, Mr. Smigel. I will turn it over to you,
thank
sir.
Thank you, Mr. Smigel. There's nothing left to say. thank you for coming, and I think this is important to have this conversation, because this is very similar to code enforcement. Citizens believe that there are people who drive around the city looking for streets being out, lights out, and are reporting those daily. And we get this with code enforcement, that they think that we have staff or somebody around that is pointing out where there's a code enforcement issue, and that's not, we do have a citizen complaint-driven system for most of these types of issues.
I have fallen into the trap sometimes of beating up Dominion Energy in a Civic Week meeting. The reality is that anytime I've reached out to Dominion, you guys have been wonderful in responding back and taking care of an issue. And oftentimes what we find out is that it was never even reported, that, you know, a light could have been out for like a whole year. I go to a Civic League meeting and a citizen says, that light pole has been out for a full year, but it was never reported. I do appreciate you two explaining the transition that happened to outdoor lighting, because there was a period of time, and I think Max told me about that as well, that there was a disconnect. I think you guys went through some contractor issues as well, and things were not getting done in a timely manner. But when we reported that, you responded to it. So we appreciate, you know, that honesty and transparency with it. So I have a few things. The first one is, when you guys do fix the lights, can you also replace the numbers that identify the lights where they're, I don't know if you're doing that already, because when citizens are calling in, they can't get the pole number, and some of the light poles are not at intersections, so it's hard to find, you know, tell somebody where the light is out, and if you guys are not driving out there at night seeing that that light is out. So I know over time, particularly in Ocean View, because of the water, those corrode and they fall off, and so numbers disappear and stuff. So I don't see that happening as much, but that's just a recommendation that if you can fix that, that'd be great. And it's the same thing with the ones that are underground, that are lower. Our crews on city property and Parks Recreation, they like to hit those with weed whackers, and those are stickers. And over time, you can't read the pole numbers anymore. So trying to identify when you have maybe 50 underground light poles on one property and one's out, you can't identify because the number's missing. So you're like, okay, it's located at the right side of this building and the front of this door, and it's like, how do you get that exact location? So that would be helpful. I think the city also needs to work on how we report issues, particularly when it comes to accidents taking out poles. I've had over the last year multiple times in which an accident has taken out a pole and Dominion knew nothing of it. And that's on the city's end to make sure that it is being reported. I just had two taken out and within 1 week by Captain Groovy's on Shore Drive. And I'm assuming they were reported in, and those will take longer because you're going to have to order poles and things to replace those. But we have to do better on our end. I think it's actually not good that it's 300. I know you're proud of that. There should be a lot more reported because there's definitely more than 300 lights out. And that shows that there's a disconnect with how we're reporting these. And I think, too, Chip, maybe we can work with Dominion, that if our officers are actually reporting these or staff is doing it, we need to have a marker system that says that this pole has already been called in by our staff. So if they're putting their slips on it at when they go and respond, but then we could be doubling up efforts if we have an officer patrolling an area one shift, and then another officer goes by that same pole, how do they know that it's been called in already? Do we have a system even here internally that's doing that? It could be simple, just putting a fluorescent sticker on it somewhere so that the next staff person says, oh, that pole's been reported already by police or a staff member. And that maybe that's something we can work with you guys on if you let us put stuff on your poles, you know, just so that you know that we've reported it when you get to it as well. I don't know. Just something like that. I'm curious about adding new lights. I know we've provided some streets to Pete. I've got some neighborhoods that are just in huge deficits of lights, not even just replace them with LED. They just don't have any lights. What is the cost to the city? I think $200,000 is embarrassing as a city this size. We've got to do more. Maybe my math is off, but it would be about $5 million to replace all of the city LED. $150 a light pole or something. I think that maybe we need to look at some of the ARPA funds we're not spending and work with Dominion and just get this done. We did Hampton Boulevard, I think part of Chesapeake Boulevard from Five Points to Little Creek Road. There have been some major roads that have been done, but it does make a difference. I'm not going to say that not having lights equals crime. There is some correlation in some places with that. But just because the light's out on a corner doesn't mean that, you know, there's going to shooting is going to happen there. But there are sensitive areas that we do need to make sure are well lit to prevent, you know, crimes from happening. We also need to involve the schools in this. We've talked about this as well. that this, if the school system is responsible for the lights on their property and they're paying that bill, how do we get them on board as also doing LED, whether we're given an incentive and paying for part of this. But I think overall it's just healthy for the whole city to work together with the school system, not put it, just tell the school system it's up to you to do it, because they're going to say they don't have the funding to do it, and whether or not that can happen, because that's also where there's a possibility for crime, there's recreation, we have a lot of events at our schools, and we want to keep those lit up as well. But I'm hoping we can get some information about the new lights and how that process goes. So how does the city determine if a request goes in for new lights? So I sent Pete, Old Ocean View Avenue from Little Creek Road to Bayview is just completely dark, and it's a major road. How do I make sure that that is a priority for the city to get that on the list? But if we're only putting $200,000 in, it could take 5-10 years before that happens. But how do we make sure that those areas that are dark are getting that priority, as part of this? But Paul has been great. Dominion's been great. I've sent in polls. I have this weird, I told you all, photographic memory where I can remember where a poll is out, and I can identify that on a map. But really, a council member shouldn't be driving around, figuring out where the lights are out. So we've got to figure that out and how we can better coordinate that as a city, and marking those so that we're not duplicating that work.
Thank you, Mrs. Smigel. Okay, Ms. Doyle, then Ms. McClellan.
Paula, thank you for being here today with your team. And thank you for being really our only agenda item today, which gives us a good chance to ask some good questions. I do think there's some confusion of our residents, because I'm at Civil League meetings and they're told, call Norfolk Cares and let them know when the lights are out. Really, that's not the solution. We should be directing them straight to Dominion. So I think we need to do some education among our neighborhood services folks and ourselves so that we know exactly where to direct people, because I think people now are calling Norfolk Cares and I don't know where they're going from there.
We give them exactly what you saw.
Okay.
So our Norfolk Cares staff do not take down a poll number or anything. We direct them exactly to the information that you saw here.
So I think we probably just need to do better education on the resident side, to be honest, so that they're not even bothering Norfolk Cares and having that be another step in the process, which is frustrating for the resident. And then what is the service level agreement for getting poles replaced that are literally just wiped out, as Tommy said?
Typically, that would be more like an underground cable replacement, which is up to 45 days, sometimes more. It depends on the availability of the material. It depends on permitting, and what I will say about the City of Norfolk permitting is that it's a very easy process, and the city makes it very easy for Dominion to make repairs to streetlights if we do ever need a permit. But it does add a little bit of time there. And then, typically I would say 45 days or so, depending on the availability of the material.
Yeah, and actually, Mr. Smigel, the two that he mentioned, we were going to get them, and we were going to get one.
Yeah.
And now there's two.
Within 2 days, I think.
Yes. But we were going to have them picked up today, but another call came in and redirected.
So will those be LEDs? Will those be LEDs?
Yes.
I think they've been replaced.
One was LED, one was not. So,
okay.
Yeah.
But they'll both be, because when we have to replace the pole, we replace the fixture as well.
Right. So don't ever stand by that pole, because I think one of them has been hit quite a few times. So
so there are two poles that are beyond the Bramelton Avenue Bridge that I gave to Pete Burek. One's been out for years, frankly. The pole's taken out, never replaced, never repaired. And then one recently was taken out by a car accident. And someone, I don't know if it was the city, because I also called it in terms of the debris of the pole was next to the light rail line, which was frankly quite dangerous. So someone had to quickly go out and remove that. But it's probably been 15, 20 days, 30 days since that pole's been taken out.
Just like Mr. Stabler said, with those lights, and they're in the meeting, so it's traffic control and whatever comes with it. But what we think of first is just the safety aspect of it, getting them picked up, getting it cleaned up. And that's really that first trip, that's all we do.
And you're responsible for the pickup and the cleanup?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. I would send one of my teams out here with an old truck and pick it up, put it on the trailer, take it out.
So if we see that pole sitting there for a certain amount of time, it could be possible that it never made it to them. So traffic officer who responded, or it could have been that nobody responded because the accident happened in the middle of the night. So if we see a pole sitting on the ground for, or broken in half for like a week, then that may be an indication that it wasn't called in.
Then you email Pete Burek like I did, and he takes care of it for you. So thank you, Pete.
Or do we just call the number?
Which I wasn't aware of at the
time.
Well, I would agree. I think there's a little bit of that is the truth. Everyone thinks everyone else reports it.
I think it's just important that the service level agreements are apparent and accounted for, honestly. But thanks for being here today.
Okay, Ms. McClellan.
Thank you. So on the Dominion Energy site, you can input the poll number. And if you input the poll number and it's already in the system, is there a message that states what the status of that is?
When you use the online web form as a private citizen, it's an email web form, so it's an email. So that system is not a sophisticated system that's checking to see if it's already been reported. It actually goes to representatives in our customer care center that then enter that information. And if they see in the system it's already been entered, the email back to the person that reported it online is, here's the work request number, it was already reported. So they're still going to get information back. Even if it was already reported, we won't enter a duplicate report for that same light, though. But the form that, if you're looking at it on your phone right now, it's pretty unsophisticated. It just creates an email that goes to that customer care center.
And is there there had been a website where you could go check all of the current status of all the lights that are out?
That is just for VEPCO customers, so city staff certainly can use that. It's not for private citizens, though.
We have two places on our city website that have links to all the current status. It's GIS. I sent you guys that form. So,
and that may be true if you are taking information from Dominion system and putting it on the city system.
Yeah, well, I think, we're go ahead, Pete. Yeah.
We're taking the reports from their outage system, right, from Frida and posting them. And so,
run it through Civic Lab, GIS.
It's on our data.
But it's not their system yet. I mean, we're just using their data.
So recognizing that reporting is a big part of this issue, right? Just as we do, it's daylight savings time, check your batteries and your smoke detectors. As a city, can we say, it's daylight savings time, report all the lights out in your community. And so, you know, twice a year, we have a system and we say, this is how you do it. Here are the placards that you should look for. Just sort of an educational campaign, because it's only as good as the reporting, and I just think that we could communicate that better.
Yeah, and when this came up with council, we had this conversation earlier before, you know, we had brought Dominion in. We then did do a push on our platforms and said, hey, if you see a light out, contact Dominion, here's the number. We can absolutely sort of schedule it for maybe two or three times during the year to tell everybody, you know, if you see something.
Halloween's coming up. Make sure the little ones are safe. You know, I just think we should, and I'm sure there are other municipalities that do this. So we have a lot of lights out that are within the vicinity of water. So Mowbray Arch, Colonial Place, I'm sure others. Is there a correlation to the water? Yeah, so the water in the underground lights, the cables. Yeah, because there's a few places that floods around here, you might know.
Yeah, that's right.
And we've been on them multiple times. Part of the underground replacement, that's what it is for Mayflower, Mowbray, Bath, where it was. Used to be all aluminum cable years ago. Now we use copper. Copper holds up much better in the elements, underwater, what have you. Talking with Frida, I know no one wants overhead lights. And I said, Frida, Mayflower, I said, let me set 30-foot poles and pull it overhead. Kind of lightheartedly, but that wouldn't go. I know that wouldn't go. But I was trying to make a point about flooding and the constant underground. And every time we have one, we're replacing spans when they go out.
Right.
But that's a long ways around.
Well, and I would just end with, I would echo Tommy's comments and Mamie's as well. I think, and I've told you this, I really think we should use our ARPA funds. If there's a 2 to 3 year ROI on this, and we'll have success. From there on out, we'll also see cost savings. I don't understand why, and it helps with our energy consumption. I just think this is a win all the way around, and to the extent that we can fast track this, I would really like to do that. And if they're gonna last 4 to 5 times longer, provide better lighting, I mean, it just seems like it's a great way. And we should prioritize those areas of the city where we have specific safety concerns too.
Okay, Mr. Thomas.
Thank you. Just to follow up on that last point, if this body determines to move forward with funding significant conversions per year, do you all have the ability to move forward with that at the same rate that we can fund it?
Yes, absolutely. We'd be happy to meet with you and look at your conversion strategy, share with you all the data you need to make those decisions. If I could just give you an example of another significantly sized locality with a number of lights that have started conversions, they're on pace at about 1,000 a month. It's a locality that has about 60,000 lights. So that was their strategy. So we can work with the city of Norfolk and based on your funding and you pick the areas that start. That's up to you, not us. It just gives you a guideline, like 1,000 a month. And if you want more than that, we have dedicated resources. We could make resource changes to make sure we meet your expectations.
Thank you very much.
Okay, well, let me close by saying thank you again to all of you, Anita, Paula, Rick, Jerry. Thank you for coming from Loudoun County. I would just add two things. One, as relates to outage and damaged poles, the best way that Dominion will respond is by capturing the pole number and reporting the pole number. Just to say that a pole is down on Tidewater Drive or a lights out on Granby, it better helps the city and Dominion if that pole number is also reported with that. As it relates to directional lighting, maybe you asked about residential and commercial lights on private property. A lot of times customers will ask Dominion to install a directional light, and that light will go out as well. However, there's a pole number, and that should be reported as well. As it relates to using ARPA funds, I would like to see your new technology as relates to, if we go down this path, what's the latest technology as relates to the lighting? Can we adjust the dim, increase the lighting in high crime areas where there may be a public safety concern? What about a dashboard with that technology? Is there a way to incorporate some technology? So maybe we don't want our grandfather's lighting. We want 21st century lighting. If we're going to spend millions of dollars, what would be the new technology? You don't have to answer it right now unless you have an answer.
I'll give a short answer to that, because you're right on track, and it's funny I use the statement, this isn't your grandfather's street light. We are on that path, and we're not a year or two away yet. We're focused on LED conversions, but the LED fixture, that new technology, is the first step. It's the platform for future opportunities. Future opportunities such as smart lighting, so having the lights be able to report themselves out. So our conversation, most of it today, goes away at some point in the future.
Thank you so much.
And that would be, basically a smartphone on a pole is essentially what it is. So there, we can certainly get you more details on that as we move forward with value conversion.
I'll close with this. No, go ahead.
For a pole that doesn't have a number on it anymore because it was taken out to the ground or close to it, how do you report that?
One to the left, one to the right of it.
Well, but the other one was taken out too, so they're next to each other.
Yeah. And I would
say street address is typically what they'll ask for.
Okay.
And I ask that so that people hear that are listening and watching today.
See, Tommy said something earlier. Dominion has been very responsive to the city when we call and we have the right information. So Morgan, thank you for what you do here on the ground. And again, thank you all for what you do for the city of Norfolk. We appreciate you being a corporate citizen as well. So thank you. And at that note, we're going to ask our guests to be excused. And Mr. Bull, if you would call the roll.
Excuse me, Mayor, I'm going to send these cards around so you have Morgan's and mine.
Please do, Paula.
You need Thank you, Ms. Paula.
I move that members of the council assemble and form a closed meeting on November 9, 2021 at 5:01 p.m. in the 10th floor conference from the City Hall building, the City of Norfolk, for the purposes which are set out in clauses 29 and 7, subsection A of section 2.2-3711 of the Virginia Freedom of Information Act as amended. Clause 29, discussion of the award of a public contract involving the expenditure of public funds military circle area where discussion in an open session would adversely affect the bargaining position of the public body. Clause 7, consultation with legal counsel pertaining to litigation or such consultation in an open meeting would adversely affect the litigating posture of the public body, the St. Paul's area, and the CUP revocation.
Okay.
Ms. Doyle.
Aye.
I'm sorry. We had a third item relating to the origami CUP. If you could.
He called it.
Oh,
I said
sorry.
It. He said it.
Yeah, great. Thank you.
Ms. Doyle.
Aye.
Ms. Johnson.
Aye.
Ms. McClellan.
Aye.
Mr. Riddick.
Aye.
Mr. Royster.
Aye.
Mr. Smigel.
Aye.
Mr. Thomas.
Aye.
Dr. Alexander.
Aye.